notice that today's bulletin looks just a little different than what we're kind of used to. And so some would say this is new for us, others would say this is old school for us. And so you get to determine what that is for you. But I'm going to show you kind of how I would use this if I were you. So I'm going to take this and kind of sneak it into the toward the back of the hymnal, and then kind of close it up, and then this should hang out, and you're going to be able to follow along with the service using that. So we will be relying heavily upon our ELW this season. And if you're having a hard time seeing it, we might have some large prints left, and so let them know. I want you squinting, you're struggling through the service. So we will have more of those available this season. Anything else on there? Oh, yes, thank you. Okay, so you're going to see in there, we're going to start with our Thanksgiving for Baptism, which says inside folder. So if you just open the booklet, you're going to see right there on the left is the Thanksgiving for Baptism. And then the next thing is this big, bold ELW number. That's a hymn. So that'll be at the back of your hymnal. And then when you see the little E with page number, that's going to be in the front. And I will help guide this as we go through the service. I promise it will not be that hard. And I promise this is not forever. This is for a season. And so we're going to try this. We're going to save paper, and we're going to celebrate the risen Lord. I invite you to stand as we join together in our Thanksgiving for Baptism. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, by whose hand we are given new birth, by whose speaking we are given new life.
Amen.
Joined in Christ in the waters of baptism, we are welcomed, restored, and supported as citizens of the new creation. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. Holy God, holy and merciful, holy and mighty, you are the river of life. You are the everlasting wellspring. In mercy and might, you have freed us from death and raised us with Jesus, the firstborn of the dead. In baptismal waters, our old life is washed away. And in them, we are born anew. Glory to you for the oceans and lakes, for rivers and streams. Honor to you for waters that wash us clean, quench our thirst, and nurture both crops and creatures. Praise to you for the life-giving water of baptism, the outpouring of the Spirit of the new creation. Wash away our sin and all that separates us from you. Empower our witness to your resurrection. Strengthen our resolve in seeking justice for all. Satisfy the world's need through this living water. Where drought dries the earth, bring refreshment. Where despair prevails, grant hope. Where chaos reigns, bring peace. We ask this through Christ, who with you in the Spirit reigns forever.
Amen.
We join in our gathering song, number 646.
Thank you.
with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Did through him alone. yourselves know, this man handed over to you according to the defined plan and foreknowledge of God. You crucified and killed by the hands of those outside the law, but God raised him up, having freed him from death, because it was impossible for him to be held in its power. For David says concerning him, I saw the Lord always before me, for he is at my right hand, so that I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart was glad, and my tongue rejoiced. Moreover, my flesh will live in hope. For you will not abandon my soul to Hades, or let your Holy One experience corruption. You have made known to me the ways of life. You will make me full of gladness with your presence. Fellow Israelites, I may say to you confidently of our ancestor David, that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Since he was a prophet, he knew that God had sworn with an oath to him that he would put one of his descendants on his throne. Foreseeing this, David spoke of the resurrection of the Messiah, saying, he was not abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh experience corruption. This Jesus God raised up, and of that all of us are witness. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jewish authorities. Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing, you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. I invite the children present to come forward. Sad, right? says, peace be with you. He brings something new. He brings something wonderful to them. He meets them right where they are. So when we pass the peace, we're not saying hi to people, though sometimes we take it that way. But it's our opportunity to say, I see you just as you are, and I love you, and I share God's peace with you. And that's kind of beautiful, right? That's something different. So let's share the peace with one another real quick, and then we'll say prayer. Is that okay? I'll pass it down. How's that? Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Can you give it to Bryson? Say, peace be with you. And Bryson, can you pass it along with me? Peace be with you. Very good. All right, let us pray, everybody, and you can repeat after me, all right? Hi, God.
Hi, God.
We thank you.
We thank you.
Today for peace.
Today for peace.
We thank you.
We thank you.
For seeing us.
For seeing us.
As we are.
As we are.
And bringing something new.
And bringing something new.
And together we pray this in the name of Jesus. We say, Amen. All right, you can return back to your seats. You guys, peace. Say peace to people as you walk around. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. They say one thing is certain in life, that is death. I'm sure that this is a part of what made the disciples' Easter experience so challenging. But this truth doesn't make navigating the death of those closest to us any easier, though, does it? We navigate grief for what no longer will be. We experience despair, sometimes even denial, as we face such significant change in our lives. And oftentimes, there is fear. Fear of the unknown. Fear of not knowing how to survive without this person. Fear of being alone or not having the support that you did before. This morning we meet the disciples as they navigate a similar kind of fear when peace seems to be the farthest from their lived experience. The gospel writer John draws us into a small room that first Easter evening. All the disciples but one are gathered there. Mary had just told them that she has seen the Lord, that he is alive, that he will soon ascend to God. When we meet these disciples this night, they are far, far from living in peace, far from shouting Alleluia, far from celebrating resurrection. We read that they have locked themselves in this room for fear of the Jewish authorities. They are full of sorrow, doubt, and disbelief. Jesus' ministry had come to such a terrible and unexpected ending. His death, on of all things, the cross. Then this news of Jesus' body being missed, his rising from the dead. Talk about turmoil. It seems a sensible thing to do amid this fear and doubt that they have is to lock the doors and try to make sense of all that has happened. Perhaps peace is a regular part of your everyday experience. Perhaps it is not. I can confidently say that with two rambunctious kids, their activities, two dogs, and my wife and I's full-time jobs, peace is something we often find to be in short supply. And that's just the normal day-to-day. We know turmoil too. Like the disciples, we know what it is like to lose those we love and rely upon. We know what it is like to be thrown off by the unexpected. We know what it is like to have our lives shaken by incredible challenges. We see this turmoil not only in our homes, but in our nation and around the world too. There are so many challenges in our lives. The world, and those challenges can be locked behind doors out of fear. What it's like to need peace. None of the events of the past few days had made any sense to the disciples. Yes, Jesus had warned them that this would happen, but they never were able to accept that news. He was their friend, their Savior, their Messiah. They ponder all these things in their hearts together in this room. And it is here that Jesus appears. Death cannot keep him out. A locked door will not stop him. Jesus shows up. And more than that, he offers them shalom, peace. He does this not once, not twice, but three times in our reading today. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you. Peace be with you. Jesus shows up in that room. He sees the disciples' doubt and fear, their questions as they navigate all this distress. And we find that his response is one of understanding and compassion. Jesus brings about a peace that seems impossible to them in this moment.
Yummy.
The truth is, they don't have to have it all together. They don't need to have it all figured out. Jesus does not reprimand them for forgetting what he had taught them. No. Instead, he meets them right where they are. Even Thomas. And gives them exactly what it is that they so desperately need. A peace that calms their hearts. A peace that can come only from Jesus. A peace that gives them a strength and excitement to proclaim, "We have seen the Lord." The season of Easter continues with the good news that we need not be perfect. We need not have it all together. We need not be without fear or doubt. The risen Jesus meets us where we are with a care and a peace that surpasses all understanding. No, this does not mean that we will not experience turmoil or chaos in our lives any longer. It is a part of what it means to be human in relationship with others. It does mean that as we wrestle with it all, we are met by the one we so need, with words we so desperately need to hear, words that calm our hearts and help us journey on. Peace be with you. And invite you to pray with me. God, we come to you a people with various experiences and numerous challenges. Meet us where we are. Care for us deeply and show us the peace that our hearts so need. The peace that can come only from you. We pray this in your Son's name. And together we say.
Amen.
Thank you.
in the hope and joy of the resurrection, let us pray for the church, the world, and all in need. God of rebirth, the good news of your resurrection brings refreshment to a weary world. Following the woman at the tomb, empower us to boldly share your radical love through our words and our work. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
As you breathed your spirit into the disciples, breathe your spirit of healing upon all creation. Nourish the earth with sufficient rains. Strengthen us to counter the effects of pollution and destruction. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You prepared the disciples for their ministry by calming their fears and granting them your peace. Equip our community leaders. Give them a spirit of peace and hearts that burn for justice, that their leadership reflects your love. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You come among us in unexpected ways. Send us to those who hide in fear or question your love. Be a healing presence for any isolated by addiction, incarceration, mental illness, chronic pain, sickness, or grief, especially those we name now silently and aloud. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
As you met the disciples on the road to Emmaus, show us your presence along our journeys. Bless our doubts and questions. Provide trusting and safe relationships for all ages to nurture our connection to you and one another. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Resurrecting God, you bring us to new life every day. Thank you for blessing us with companions on our faith journey, especially those who now rest in your love, including our friend Louis Mather. Strengthen us with the eternal peace of your promises. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Rejoicing in the victory of Christ's resurrection, we lift our prayers and praise to you, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share that abounding peace of God with one another.
Thank you.
thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying has destroyed death, and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so, with Mary Magdalene and Peter, and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Thank you.
Thank you. On Friday, Louis Masser entered the church triumphant. We sent yesterday an email out with his obituary and more information, but visitation will be this Wednesday from 2 to 7 at Marysville Funeral Home, and then the funeral will be Thursday at 11 here at the church, with visitation beginning at 10. Today we have an intergenerational movie following our service, and we will be watching Disney's Encanto and enjoy a delicious lunch together. And so this is an event for all people of all ages, and you won't want to miss it. So I invite you to stick around for the fun. The Golden Heart Senior Lunch that is happening here in Marysville every other month or so is this coming weekend, and we do have 5 tickets left. Because after when the tickets came in, Pilgrim's been a little slower to get those out. But if they're not in your mailbox, come and tell me why, and see me after worship, and I do have a few more that I can. I will be out of town Monday through Wednesday for my final annual First Call Theological Retreat. That's a mouthful. but it will be a good time. We will gather with different First Call pastors in this area, which means not just Southeast Michigan, but the whole region. So Indiana, Kentucky, Ohio, Michigan. It will be a wonderful time. We will gather for worship, but also we're going to be learning things around administration. And so the secretary for the ELCA and the denomination's council, legal council, will be there teaching us, which will be quite wonderful. And so I will be back on Thursday, of course, for Lewis's funeral. Are there any other announcements? Fred, you are ready.
Yes. Just want to say the Board of Outreach yesterday began counting the many 40 days of Lent savings that came in. We had 42 baskets returned and almost $1,800. That will go to help people in our community that need a hand up. We're just so blessed for all that participated. And 2 more bags were brought in the church this morning, so those numbers will be even higher. If you have a bag that you haven't returned yet, they're still welcome. But thank you all so much for that huge gift to our community.
Any other announcements? So Alex and Heather reached out and let me know that they will be married 60 years this year, this month, this week, right? We're strictly narrowing that down. This hour. and so they wanted to renew their vows, and we actually have a rite that comes out of our hymnal, our ELW, for this, to celebrate many years of marriage and to look forward and pray and support for them as they move on into the next several years. And so I'm going to invite you to come forward as you affirm your vows. You can stand right above the step if that's okay. Oh, you should be. There you go. Alex and Heather, I invite you to affirm your vows to one another as husband and wife. And you will repeat after me. Heather, I invite you to start. You can look at each other. Heather, you repeat after me. In the presence of God in this community, I affirm my vow to you, Alex. With thanksgiving, I promise to share with you all that is still to come and to be faithful to you until death parts us. In the presence of God in this community, I affirm my vow to you, Heather.
I affirm my vow to you, Heather.
With Thanksgiving, I promise to share with you.
I promise to share with you
all that is still to come.
All that is still to come.
And to be faithful to you.
And to be faithful to you.
Until death parts us. Heather and Alex, in the presence of God in this assembly, affirm and give thanks for their life together as husband and wife. Those whom God has joined together, let no one separate. Amen.
Thanks be to God.
People of Pilgrim and all those gathered here with Alex and Heather, will you continue to support and care for them, sustain and pray for them in times of trouble, give thanks with them in times of joy, honor the bonds of their covenant, and affirm the love of God reflected in their life together. If so, boldly say, we will.
We will.
Let us pray. Eternal God, our Creator and Redeemer, we We thank you for providing the Murkows these 60 years together. Grant that they, abiding in your love and faithfulness, may continue to share with one another their joys and sorrows and all that the years will bring. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
We applause.
Share the good news.
Thanks be to God.